Good morning and welcome to Onod Investigates, a subsidiary of OT Investigates, a subsidiary of the Hobby Breakfast podcast. I'm your host, OT, and I'm joined today by Onod.
Hello. I like how I'm not the host of the thing named after me. I'm not that important.
It was just done to honor you. Like it's not a
Okay.
reference to any effort you've put
Yeah.
into the video. It's just
That's fair.
it's not a memorial because you're not dead. So today we're going to be talking about what type of MESBG player are you? Are you the good kind or are you the bad kind? I'm just kidding. There's no good or bad.
There
It's
definitely
all
is.
okay. It's all just what you enjoy.
Yeah,
So we are basing this off a Magic the Gathering article, which when was it? Was it published a while ago or is it relatively new or?
this is old news. So this is like almost 20 years ago, Jesus. This is like old school in the Magic community, and I actually roughly got the idea off a 40K podcast where the people on that were Magic players, and so they were like briefly kind of explaining what their thoughts were for 40K. I can't remember the name of the podcast, but I will find it out and edit it in, and it will appear on screen now. But this is an article written quite a long time ago. I think it has been developed and worked on since and stuff, but it's basically this kind of idea that I think it's the people that make Magic the Gathering. When they were like designing and thinking about it, they broadly came up with different player models. I don't know what the word would be.
Types, stereotypes. I don't really know.
Maybe, but they're kind of broad, kind of working out why do people play a game. They're specifically looking at a card game, but I think it's applicable really to any game. And thinking about then how those players interact with each other and where you get kind of crossovers and just sort of really trying to understand why some people enjoy certain things and other people's don't, but you can all enjoy the wider game, if that makes sense.
Okay. So we're going to begin by going through the sort of different types of, in this case, Magic the Gathering player, but later on we will try and relate them to MESBG. It's worth noting, these are not like strictly, they don't exist in a vacuum, and like we'll go into it later as well. They do interact with each other. Like you can get one who's a bit of one kind, a bit of another. So it's not all just specifically fitting into these four categories.
Yeah, you're unlikely to be 100% any of them. So the first one is called Timmy or Tammy. I think they're actually named after people that the author, who is called Mark Rosewater, actually knows. So the concept behind a Timmy is that they are playing for the experience. So they're not really interested in any end goal as such, which differentiates them from the other players. They're more about having fun in the moment. I think that's kind of key to understanding Timmy. Now, what fun they're having in the moment is what differentiates different kinds of Timmy. So some of them are going to have fun literally just rolling dice in the case of a war game, or in the case of Magic, just playing exciting cards. Some of them are going to have fun from maybe being a bit more competitive. So you get quite a broad range of Timmies and Tammies.
Yeah, and I think this is maybe actually they're all fairly broadly defined, but I think this one especially could have quite a broad variety of people who would fit into this category, and they definitely interact with all the other ones quite a lot. Next one is well, next one we're going to talk about is Johnny slash Jenny. So this is someone who's looking to kind of go their own way. They're looking to be a bit creative. They won't chase the meta, but they're still looking to sort of play the game well, in their opinion. It's just they might have a different approach to maybe the rest of the people who tend to play the game.
Yeah, and the really interesting thing about Johnny and Jenny's is because they are quite creative, although they will often not follow the meta, they can actually create a meta which is kind of like the weird kind of overlap again that you get. So they don't chase the meta, but they can set a meta because they're creative in the way that they do stuff.
Mm. And like it may not even necessarily be about winning. It may just be proving to themselves or others that actually what this wacky thing that they've thought up could perhaps work if it was maybe better defined, or, you know, they were taking the game a bit more seriously.
Yeah, and I think for a card game, there's quite a distinctive idea for Johnny. It's they're trying to make a set of cards which no one else is using work together. Mm-hmm. And they're trying to think to themselves, like, creative concepts. Can you make a deck which is based around a very kind of specific idea that they've come up with work? That's kind of where it sits in the magic side of stuff. So they get a lot of enjoyment out of theory, deck building, I guess list building in miniature games. And then the enjoyment in playing the game is less about the game itself. And this is what makes them different to a Timmy. The game is about putting the theory into practice rather than them actually enjoying the process of the game. So they are enjoying the destination rather than the journey, because they want the proof of concepts, basically.
Now, the next one is Spike. Spike is out to prove something. Tricky to say what that is. It might vary between spikes. But essentially they're out to, they see the game as like something that can be won or like completed, I guess. And it's kind of a challenge to do that. Obviously in like a competitive PvP scenario, be that like, you know, computer game or card game or tabletop game, it might be about beating and comparing to others, or it might just be this notion that they have that's quite sort of based within themselves about like a goal they want to achieve, whether that's improving or, you know, winning a tournament or whatever.
Yeah, so spikes, like if we're imagining that someone is, say, like doing a Rubik's Cube, a spike might be interested in completing it faster than someone else, or they might be interested in seeing if they can get a best time. Or they might be interested in seeing like what's the fewest amount of moves that you can complete a Rubik's Cube in. So they're not necessarily inherently competitive, but I think this is where maybe you start to, I think more spikes are likely to be competitive than the others, just because it's inherently about they're playing the game because they want to prove either that they're good at the game, or they want to prove that, you know, they can do something. So it's about that kind of seeking perfection, I guess. And that often leads spikes in the magic world, they often chase the meta. Mm-hmm. Because a lot of spikes, not all spikes, we should be clear, but a lot of spikes perceive the meta as being like the way to complete the game. That's like the perfect way to play. So they will play the meta deck because it's the most efficient, it's the most likely to win, and they want to prove themselves by being able to play it. Mm-hmm. Some spikes, though, will try to break the meta, or they will be trying to build a fun but competitive list. So it would be wrong to just generalize spikes as being purely out there just to win. Yeah, but I think that the try-hard players are likely to have a bit of a spike in them.
Mm-hmm. And then finally, we have an interesting one. Somebody who arguably, in my opinion at least, maybe doesn't even necessarily enjoy the game in the traditional sense. So it might be that they enjoy collecting or painting or, you know, the lore of the game or whatever, rather than the actual sort of mechanics and playing of the game in and of itself. Which I think is quite an interesting concept, and is maybe quite weird to actually imagine for people who don't see the game that way. But it's an interesting one.
So this is the Vorthos, which apparently, if you read the article, which I strongly encourage people to do because it's very well written, but apparently the person that Vorthos is named after was also called John, so used their D&D character name.
Nice.
So this is their D&D character name. But anyway, I actually think Vorthos fits better with miniature wargaming, because I think in a card game, the concept of somebody only being interested in things like the art on the card or collecting the cards, I think that there are people who are like that. But I think that a game like Magic, a lot of people are going to be more interested in the playing. I think maybe a game like Pokemon, there's more of a collector scene. I'm not saying there's not a collector scene in Magic. I'm just saying that, like, in terms of percentages of the player base, I think in miniatures, there's going to be loads of people who are mostly painting, hobbying, and then they play the game as something to do. So yeah, the concepts, I guess the broad idea is that this is about, like, they're interested in the feeling that the game gives them.
Yeah.
So they want things to feel right. So they'll inherently want a character, if we think about Middle-earth, to play like they do in the movie. They want it to be lore accurate. They want to have their miniatures look right. They want them to play right. They want them to collect an army that's right, however they define right.
Yeah.
And I think that leads a lot to a lot of this person not playing very frequently.
Yeah.
They're not, like, in it to just game. They're in it for the wider side of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Should we briefly discuss where we think that we sit on this, and then we'll start talking? Because I think it would be interesting maybe for us to give us a go at identifying ourselves.
Yeah.
And then see if the other person agrees.
Mm.
I think that I'm mainly on the side. I'll put the spectrum up so people can see. I'm definitely on the Vorthos side rather than Spike side.
Yeah.
I'm not sure if I'm more. I don't really know, to be honest, if I do find just the physical playing of a game always the fun.
Mm.
So I think that I'm probably somewhere more down towards the Johnny. I think that I more enjoy the kind of theoretical side and trying to make lists that make sense rather than just rolling dice and that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
So that's where I would identify myself.
Yeah.
I don't know if you agree with that.
That's pretty fair. I think, to be honest, you're probably fairly towards the center in terms of the vertical line. So the center vertically, and then I'd put you really far to the left horizontally. So if you're using the same spectrum as I've got here, like, probably towards the bottom of the mainly a hobbyist thing, like, kind of around that area.
I think
you wouldn't do the game if there wasn't a hobby aspect to it.
No, probably not. It's sort of like, there's very few games where I think that I play them for the game in itself. And I'd say the only games which are like that tend to be video games for me.
Yes. Okay.
Where do you think you would be?
I think I'm a pretty stereotypical Johnny would be my theory. I think in terms of the Spike Vorthos argument, I don't really know. I think I was definitely a Spike at the beginning, but I think as time has passed, I've stopped trying to set, like, hard targets when I do things to do with SBG, because I just don't find it particularly helpful. And also, I'm not very good at the game, so I frequently let myself down. And I have actually got more into the hobbying side recently. Like, I do actually own a few armies now that I have not much intention of playing. I just kind of have them because I thought the sculpts were cool and I kind of wanted them. So I think it's definitely been, like, a gradual shift from Spike to Vorthos over time. But I think definitely I like the list building aspect. I like trying to find things in SBG that are a bit weird and that other people might not tend to use. So I think I can definitely relate to that side of things.
Yeah, I think I'd agree. I think you've definitely been pulled towards the Vorthos the longer you've been doing it. I think you've gone from painting was just a manner of completing the army to you actually fairly enjoy the hobby side.
Yeah,
I would say that you're fairly central, actually. I think you definitely swing Johnny more than Timmy or Tammy. You're more Johnny or Jenny. You're definitely down below. But I wouldn't say you're right at the bottom.
Okay.
And I'd say you're fairly central for Spike. I don't think you...
Yeah.
I think maybe in Legion you're swinging a bit more towards a Spike, and in Middle-earth you're swinging a bit more towards a Vorthos.
Yeah, that's probably fair. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. Should we play some Mare?
Well, I think he's entirely Vorthos. No, I don't really know. I think especially with the I'd say how good Mare is at the game, and especially with the armies that he's got good with, I think he's kind of maybe a mixture of like, well, but he also quite enjoys playing the game. So maybe he's just like a bit of a Spike, and then halfway between Timmy, Tammy, Johnny, Jenny. I don't really know.
Yeah, I would say that that's roughly it. He's definitely not a Vorthos.
No.
I don't think that he would claim to be a Vorthos. Mare is definitely paint so that you have stuff ready to go. He has found Slapchop a little bit more enjoyable, but I don't think that he has any real interest in kind of doing any more hobbying than is absolutely necessary, even if he found that better than other sorts of painting.
Mm.
I think that he varies.
Yeah.
I think sometimes he's more on the Timmy side. He definitely enjoys the process of playing the game, but I think that he does also enjoy the kind of more theoretical side. So he's sort of equally split between those on the side of Spike.
I mean, I also think, like, maybe this is oversimplistic, but people who are maybe just better at the game or more experienced might tend to be a bit more Spike just because they have a more realistic understanding of where they sit within the game. So, like, they know what they can how they can expect to do in a tournament, and so they can set realistic goals. Whereas, like,
people
who are a bit less experienced or maybe not as good, like, although, if you try setting goals and frequently get let down, you may be less likely to do it. I don't know.
Arguably, because Spikes are playing to prove themselves, somebody who's been playing the game so long that they know, for example, that they're not going to win the GBHL.
Yeah,
that would suggest that they would start veering away from Spike either towards Timmy, Tammy or Johnny, Jenny.
Mm-hmm.
And they would move away from being purely Spike towards one of the other two because they have already proved themselves. And so if they're going to continue playing, they've got to do so for a different purpose.
Yeah, maybe.
Yeah. Anyway, enough about us, because who really cares? Let's talk about general ideas about where different sorts of player might actually sit. Now, the bubbles that we have in front of us might change slightly.
Yeah.
Chucked up some rough ideas as to the kind of where I thought different kinds, and we're mainly looking at Middle-earth, but it can apply to other war games as well, roughly, where they kind of sit was my thinking behind this. And I kind of felt like there were quite clear types of person in each of the corners, so to speak.
Yeah.
Should we go from 12 o'clock around?
Yes, I think that probably makes most sense.
So I feel like a social gamer, the kind of person who is going along to a weekly or fortnightly club night, mm-hmm. they're doing a bit of hobby so that they can bring it along. They're playing a few games. Maybe they don't really hit the tournament scene quite a lot. I know it seems like there's quite a few people at the club near me that I never really see their names popping up for tournaments and stuff, but they seem to have a great time just turning up every week and playing the game.
Yeah.
And this kind of, I've dubbed the social gamer, I feel like they're the kind of closest to the pure Timmy that you get without being either Vorthos or Spike. They're just kind of there to enjoy hanging out and playing the game, and there isn't really any end goal for them other than just to have fun. And I feel like that is kind of the embodiment in gaming of that group.
Mm. I think it's quite hard to be like purely any one aspect of any of these, because like even a social gamer, I guess, will have to have some inherent interest in the hobby to have done it in the first place, or
of course,
I think that's fair. I think that
a social gamer can stray into, once maybe they know the game a bit better, they want to prove themselves and start going to tournaments, so they can equally swing to the Spike as well.
Yeah, That's true.
So yeah, moving around then. Now this I think is going to be a controversial one because I think I get the feeling from reading the article that Power Gamer back in 2006, when this article's written, maybe meant something slightly different in the Magic
Right.
community. I get the sense that in 2006, the Magic community, a Power Gamer meant kind of somebody who wanted to play like the biggest, best cards and just try and brute force their way through rather than
Right.
somebody who's strictly kind of always playing the best kind of thing, if that makes sense.
Okay.
So I've kind of slightly redefined it as what I thought was like the meta chasers. And I think that they're the classic mix of a Timmy Tammy and a Spike. They're the people, and you know who you are if you're listening, who went and bought the Bears when they were good. Because you want to be playing what's good because your fun comes from being competitive. And you're going for the option, which is like the new thing, because you want that like fun. You don't want to just play something that you've played before. So you kind of chase the new thing. And I think in a game like Middle Earth, that group is probably not as big in some ways as the game like 40K, where I think it's actually quite common for people who play competitively to just buy a new army and sell their old one. I always feel like in Middle Earth, you're inherently going to have quite a lot of people who are meta chasing, so to speak, just because they want to buy a new army because that is the new army.
No, I'd agree with
And
that.
due to power creep, it just happens that new armies tend to often be better. So yeah.
And like, I'm trying to think what else would fit into that category. I mean, maybe it's stuff like if you, I don't know, bought, I guess it's anybody who tries to buy an entirely new army that I guess they then would be very willing to sell on immediately afterwards if it sort of dropped out of favor. Which as I think as you've hinted at is much more of a thing in 40K. You know, you see the memes about people who sell their lists just because of the latest rules update or whatever.
Yeah.
So I don't think it's as much of a thing in SBG because we don't get as many releases. But yeah, if we then move further down, I guess talk about the green circle, which is just the meta. That seems to be like just the purest form of spike.
Or at
So
least the closest that's going to be there. I actually think in Middle Earth that you get quite a lot of people who would fall into this bubble who are actually very good hobbyists, though. And do deeply care about the hobby. So actually it's probably more of an extended oval that goes all the way back along the line. But I think what is clear about this group is they're not a Johnny Jenner or Timmy Tammy, and they're more Spike than Orthos. And the reason why I say that is because they don't just chase the meta. They're not just buying the Bjornings because they want the flavor of the month. I feel like this is the group who are like competing for the GBHL, and they, because they have that bit of Johnny in them, understand the game and want to create kind of like something which they can use. I feel like this group are the people who can, they're so good that they can like play Black Riders competitively, and they just like absolutely know how to use it and how to win the scenarios, and they play the scenario so many times that they can just do that. And they're the ones who are at the top of, the tournaments every week with a variety of armies.
Do you think these people would be fun to play against?
I think it depends.
Yes. Because from my perspective, and I've actually been to quite a few tournaments this year, so my opinion is right. The people who are extremely good at the game tend to go one of two ways. They either need everyone to know how good they are at the game, so they massively try hard all the time, and it's kind of not the most fun experience, or they have kind of already proven to themselves that they're good at the game, and so they just kind of are very chill and like they're very solid in terms of like, you know, their discipline in the game, the way they measure things, the way they declare things, and so it's really nice to play against them. I think the other way it can go is if people really know the game, it sometimes feels like they're always trying to get an edge on you. And I think that's the way it can sometimes go against very experienced players.
Yeah. I mean, it's difficult, isn't it? Because obviously we're talking about generalization. Each person is probably going to be several points on this rather than just a single point. I think that the group who are more likely to be... I think that Timmies enjoy playing against other Timmies.
Yes.
Okay. But I think that a Timmy-Spike combination, unless they're playing against a Timmy-Spike, I think the Johnny-Jennies and the Vorthoses don't enjoy
that
quadrant. Because I think that the combination of them enjoying playing the game, but also seeking to prove they're very good, leads to the situations where they are just completely out for a different reason to you.
Yeah.
They're there to dominate. They're there to get every advantage they can because mm-hmm. their enjoyment comes from winning.
Mm-hmm.
And then I think that puts off the groups who are kind of necessarily going to enjoy the game. Because if you're playing a game that's really dull and your opponent's enjoying it because they're winning, you're just like,
fuck this.
Yeah. But I feel like the purest version of a spike isn't necessarily as bad to play against as the added Timmy to the spike in a weird way.
Mm-hmm. No, I can understand that. And again, like it varies hugely. And like, I think if we move down to like the spike Johnny thing, I think that can be quite interesting as well, because I think people, if you are looking to like break the meta or do their own thing, might be more likely to maybe be quite invested in the outcome. And like, not like, not saying they like attach value necessarily to the outcome, but like if they're looking to prove something, it might be that personally they feel that, you know, they're very invested in making this work by whatever means necessary.
Yeah, I think that the mix between Spike and Johnny can be a very dry match. I feel like that's the kind of match where they've already calculated how they're going to win.
Yeah,
so their game plan isn't, it's something that you talked about, like not interactive. Like their list might not be very interactive with you, because mm-hmm. they've been working out a way that they just win regardless of what you do, because that's obviously the, I guess, ultimate aim if you're seeking to win and also create a good list. You want your list to work regardless of your opponent rather than it works because of your opponent, right?
Yeah.
So, yeah, this is that kind of match where you turn up and they've essentially already won and you've got a very small chance because it's a dice-based game to get back into it. But
I think this kind of feels like my experience with Riv Knight, in that I was the Johnny Spike in this scenario, because like it wasn't intentional. I hadn't realized how fucking dry the list was to play. But there are some matchups with Riv Knight where like your opponent hypothetically can't win because you can just move around them all game. And I guess like something like Black Riders might fit into this category as well, because that might just be pretty miserable to play against and they can just completely outmaneuver you all game.
Yeah. Now, I don't know if meta breakers is the best term for the Middle-earth, because it's not a static meta, but it doesn't shift as quickly as games which have constant releases. Mm-hmm. So I think it's maybe more of an anti-meta kind of concept.
Okay.
Or a kind of lists which aren't the meta but can compete, but you have to be very good at understanding how they work to make it so.
I mean,
is kind of the opposite of maybe the Timmy Tammy spike, who play a list which is kind of, you can maybe get a bit more, you can make more mistakes and it still works.
Because actually, I think Mare fits into this category a bit, because like the two of the lists he took, which were Assault on Helm's Deep and Goblin Town, I don't think were ever actually the meta themselves.
But I think Assault on Helm's Deep was the meta at one point.
But definitely Goblin Town. Like,
Goblin Town, yeah.
Goblin Town's never been like a hard meta, but like it's always been kind of like, what was it? You used the word, what was it? Like a gatekeeper list or something, which is like...
Yeah, so that's like something that they talk about in like 40K and Age of Sigmar, from what I've like listened to podcasts, it's like a list in a tournament who, like in a 6-game tournament, they're the like 5-1 lists.
Yeah.
There's always a scenario that they do badly at, but you have to beat that list to win the tournament. Your 6-0 list has to beat that list, basically.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, that makes sense. Okay, if we keep moving around, we've got the sort of neither particularly Spike or Vorthos, but a bit Johnny Jenny, is just somebody who, I guess, is consistently taking the same kind of list. Now, I think this might not necessarily always be like something completely wacky and out there, but it might just be something that like they're convinced has some really powerful strengths if they're able to use it correctly. And they're just looking to sort of prove to themselves or whoever that actually it can be really good before maybe they move on to another list.
Yeah, my thinking behind this was this is like somebody who fine tunes and knows a list that's not the meta to the point where they can play it competitively against the meta.
Yeah.
So this is the kind of it's not necessarily like the fancy flavor of the month, but this is the person who buys Minas Tirith, plays them until they can play Minas Tirith because they're just very solid and they understand how all the units work and how to build a very good list to the point where they can compete and then they can win with Minas Tirith. Mm-hmm. And then maybe they keep going, or maybe they then move on to a new list because they want to again sort of prove that they can do something else. But that was how I kind of imagined this kind of somewhere more close to the purer Johnny Jenny, not near Spike or Vorthos. They're kind of in between those two.
Yeah. And I think the sort of the evolution of this, if we keep moving around, is somebody who maybe has a similar idea to that, but the list is maybe a bit more fluffy. And it's, you know, they're trying to take a sort of very fluffy list as far as it can possibly go. And, you know, maybe they care less about like the strictly winning losing thing. Maybe they're just more about like, can I do better than I did last tournament, for instance?
Yeah. This is the sort of person who brings like fellowship to a competitive tournament, and they actually are like trying to do well with it, even though they know that they're not going to win, but they're trying to like prove that they can actually get a couple wins under their belt with it. And it's sort of that kind of idea of, can I take a list which never wins and do okay?
Yeah.
And I think there's definitely people out there. Like, I saw a post a while ago of someone talking about how they'd managed to win a tournament with, like, Men of the West.
Yeah.
And it's that kind of thing of, like, they want to prove themselves, but they want to take, like, an underdog list. Mm-hmm. And they want to do something that's a bit more kind of fun, fluffy, Vorthos-side stuff. But they also want to try and do it well.
Mm.
Yeah.
Yeah, that makes sense. Okay, and then I guess we've through our final few hours on the clock. So you've got your as pure as possible Vorthos. I guess this might be somebody who very rarely plays the game, and like you know, they might I don't know they might be on like a group chat or something where people talk about the game, but they won't often come to like a games night or go to any tournaments or anything. They just have like maybe quite an expansive collection that would be very themey of MESBG.
Yeah. I think this is like someone who gets dragged along every now and again, or plays against a friend, or they have like a nice collection. So every now and again, them and their mates, you know, recreate a narrative battle, but they're not like so invested. They're always wanting to play.
Yeah.
They're just more interested in the collection side of stuff.
Yeah.
But I don't think that for like a war gamer, like the pure Thos doesn't play.
Mm-hmm.
I think that they have learned how to play so that they can use their collection. I think that's the difference.
Okay.
It's like they want the outlet to do something with their nice army so that they can play it as they imagined it in their heads, but I don't think that they haven't painted the collection to play. The playing is like the side effect of the hobbying.
Yeah. It might be that they like they've spent more time like making a display board for their army than they have like practicing the army before a tournament.
Yeah. Okay. And then that brings us to the next one. And I think this kind of proves what a church the Timmy Tammy group is. Because narrative gamers are a Timmy Tammy. They're there to have fun. They're there to enjoy the scenario. They're the people who like battle companies because they enjoy the process of watching their like company build and the fun that's involved there.
Yeah.
And they're not like looking to fine tune it like a Johnny. They're just there to see like what random skill does my guy get? This is fun.
Yeah.
But because they're more on the hobby side of stuff, they're more of a Vorthos and a Spike. Mm-hmm. Suddenly, rather than being the person who's chasing the meta, they're the person who's eating a bag of chips with their beer. And then, like, that's the weird thing about Timmy Tammy, because it's purely based on what do they define as fun.
Yeah.
They're the most diverse group, because if you don't think that winning is fun, you just think that taking part's fun, you're suddenly completely the opposite end of the spectrum.
Yeah.
I think maybe it'd be nice to sort of think about talking very briefly about kind of maybe people thinking a bit more about what each other enjoys could lead to more harmony.
I see. This is where we get preachy.
Yeah. Well, no, I think that thinking about this is important, though. Not really important, like, you know, not like climate change important.
Well, then it's a hoax.
I think I might cut that, you know. I'm not sure I even want to leave that in as a joke. Oh, dear. I just think it's interesting that I think that a lot of arguments that I see on like groups and like a lot of, I think, things which are potentials for like rifts in the community are just because I think that people view their way of playing the game as the way that everyone else does. And I think people are broadly aware of stuff like some people are more into the hobby than me. But I think that actually what's really great about this article for the magic side of stuff is that they've boiled it down into why do people do it rather than what are they doing? Like, it's scraping away that surface level of what are people doing. Mm-hmm. And I think the issue that you have in wargaming is if you look at what people are doing, everyone's painting, building and playing with their models. So I think it's quite difficult for people then to necessarily differentiate. They definitely can see that some people paint better and spend more time painting.
Mm-hmm.
But other than that, it's like quite difficult to differentiate. And I think what this down to is, no, like, of course some people want loads of fucking releases from Games Workshop because they're a Timmy Spike. They want new toys to play with and they want new stuff to change the game because that's what's fun for them. They want to try and win. They want to play with the new toys. They want to have the fun. And the fun for them is that. That's obviously very, very different to the pure Johnny who's going to mull and take loads of time playing one army to death before they even consider moving on to another one, who's like, oh, no, I want a static meta because I don't really care. I'm just interested in focusing on my one army.
Okay.
And I think that's kind of like where I would say that looking at the stuff that the Magic community have been talking about for years is quite interesting because I think that this has introduced to Magic a way of talking about stuff where people are like, oh yeah, of course some people, you know, are going to just buy the cards to put them in a nice little folder and that's like, that's just a viable way of them doing stuff. So that's why I kind of thought it was interesting to make this video, just kind of think taking a step back and going, actually, people do this for different reasons.
And like, also, I think for each person, the motivations can definitely change over time. Like, I think even for me, like, if I think back to, surely it wasn't this time last year. Yeah, it was this time last year that I was like, you know, painting up my Riven Knights. I was like, this is going to be my new thing. And then like, I think I was very much in like the Spike Johnny mindset at that point where I was like, I need to prove to myself that I can make this list work. And I couldn't make the list work because I wasn't good enough at the game. So I had a miserable time. And like the few games I did win were not fun for me or my opponent. So I changed it. And like, I went back to a list that maybe wasn't as competitive. And like, I think that did annoy me a bit at the beginning, but I was also just like, I'm going to have more fun playing this.
And as a result, I'm more likely to, you know, do more of the hobby, paint more models, all that stuff. So,
and you've understood that list better to the point where you can now get a better win rate with a list that's not as competitively viable.
True. That is true.
That.
Yeah.
I also think that I think that there's also like a natural progression within like an edition of the game. So I think at the beginning of an edition, there's like more of a top heavy, people are probably more Timmy, Tammy.
Mm-hmm.
As the edition settles, I think that you start to see a bit more migration towards the kind of Spike, Johnny. People move away from just having fun to thinking, right, now I understand the game and I'm having fun. I'm going to start boiling it down, think about the list breaking. And I think you also see that natural progression from start of an edition, people are like, great, new supplements, keep them coming. And then I think somebody who's been in the edition and who bought now like six books, they probably are moving away from that kind of thing of, actually, I don't really want any more books. They're quite expensive.
Yeah.
They're quite annoying to carry around. I have enough stuff to play with now. While somebody who's just joined the game, I think they're maybe coming in and they're like, I'm not buying all those books. I'm just buying the one that I want. And actually, why the heck aren't they giving me new stuff so that I can get excited?
Yeah.
So again, I think that there's that kind of natural transition that people probably have.
And I think it's also, I'll make an unfair comparison to Star Wars Legion right now. I feel like the Star Wars Legion community right now is in a much more, like you're talking about, maybe earlier in that evolution, in that it feels like even when unfortunately, I have to admit that, like, when I watch some of like the competitive videos or whatever online, people are still talking about the kind of enjoyment of the game type stuff rather than maybe this like hardcore list optimization that you see when the game has become like a bit more established.
Yeah, and I think it's interesting, like, you get a variety of middle earth content. There are definitely our YouTubers out there if you want to go to where, I can't remember what they're called, there's like an American one where they get people to send them lists and they will literally just go like, this is how you make your list better, you do this and this, like, we see that you want to keep this concept, so we'll keep the concept, but let's swap out that hero and stuff like that. And it's sort of like, there is such a good understanding that a lot of people can do that. And it's kind of, I guess also there's just less to customize with Middle Earth than a few war games. So there's that potentially too. But it's interesting because before we end the video, just to add in kind of one more thing, like 40K is at a point now where there's lots of interesting stuff. Like they've removed war gear costs in 40K. So equipping a miniature with one type of gun, like the two guns don't cost any more points.
Okay.
So you flat out can just maths hammer which is the best gun.
Right.
And maybe one gun is slightly better against vehicles, but you can also kind of maths hammer out an average and go, against all types of units, this one is the best. This is the best all-rounder.
Yeah.
And it's kind of led to a point where it's almost like there is just like a defined, this is how you build a unit now.
Okay.
There's not even the question of like, is it worth the points? It's just, yeah, you take that gun because it's just flat out
real good.
Better at killing stuff than this other gun. So I think there's that kind of element to 40K, which is kind of like where you remove choice almost. Like Middle Earth, you're paying a point for a spear, so you've at least got the kind of, you have to think through the consequences. But I think that's kind of going the other route where you almost maybe oversimplify potentially. I don't know exactly what. I'm not really massively up to date with 40K to know whether people like it or not.
I'm sure there's plenty of controversial opinions on both sides.
I imagine because it's 40K, they don't like it because
they don't like anything.
Like, they just seem to complain about it. But there you go. Well, let us know in the comments what sort of person you are.
Yeah.
And we will viciously mock you.
Before damage.
If you admit you're a spike, we will downvote you. We kid. I'm not.
That's such a roller coaster of a sentence.
Good. I think we'll call it there.
Yeah.
This has definitely been an OT Investigate.
Featuring Onod in his new spin-off series, Onod Investigates, coming every Thursday, 2 p.m.
I'm going to be honest, this will probably be the first and only Onod Investigate. Because the amount of time...
He solved it. He solved SBG. There's no need to investigate any further.
I just feel like the amount of times where I come up is suitable for an OT Investigates is maybe once a year.
Yeah, this was your one for this year, and then we've got.
I suppose I was kind of involved in the.
Yeah, yeah.
But you actually ended up doing, I'd say, the majority of the work, even though I was the article.
You're welcome.
Classic.
Cool. Right. Well, we're now rambling, and this will probably have to be cut. So.
No, I'll leave it in.
Okay. Fantastic.
Bye, everyone. Enjoy our fan.
Yeah.
Position, if I remember to edit it in.
Yeah.
Oh,
likely. Right. Thank you for listening. We'll see you in the next one.